Previously on the Adventure Zone.
She pulls out a flyer, and it's really gaudy. It is advertising in big, colorful block letters a place called Wonderland. On this flyer is an image, and it is, in fact, a grand relic. As the flyer says, it's the Animus Bell. My journey through Wonderland was hell. I wagered 20 years of my life in a game of chess in Wonderland, and I lost. And then an arrow comes in and hits that goat head. And with that, the chimera just instantly falls to the ground dead. You see a few people. You see a half-elf man who is kind of gruff. With him, you see a wood elf. You see a kind of scrawny human man who is no older than like 20 years old, probably. He is Lord Artemis Sterling, the ruler of Neverwinter and the most powerful man in the world.
What will our boys find in Wonderland? Well, this arc's called the Suffering Game, so nothing great. It's the Adventure Zone.
Are you guys good? Are you guys yep. Ready to be whisked away?
Whisk.
I have a little concern.
Okay.
What? Why is this arc called the Suffering Game?
Oh, don't worry about that, Dad. Oh, Daddy,
Griffin?
don't worry about it.
What's in the box? What's in the
Dad,
box?
It's like when you call like a big guy tiny. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or like a little guy biggie.
Okay, so it's really the celebrating game.
That's exactly right, Dad.
Okay, I feel a little better now. I've been concerned.
No, you have nothing to worry about. So, at the end of the last episode, you encountered these three people. You see a half-elf guy with a big old longbow, dressed in pelts, with a short, shaggy beard and dark red hair. There's an elven woman with dark purple hair, and she's got a gnarled wooden staff and the same sort of pelt armor. And you see Lord Artemis Sterling, the Lord of High of Neverwinter, and he's holding a short bow, and he's kind of standing behind the two elves, and he's dressed in this finery, and he looks at the three of you, and he says, I need a voice for this boy. He says,
Oh, use the king from Hamilton. That'd be good.
Who are you? Have you been following us?
Nah, I'm not going to deal with this for the whole arc, Griffin.
What's wrong? It's me, the Lord Artemis Sterling.
Nah,
Have you been following us? Have you been following us the whole time?
I am not going to deal with berries and cream for this whole episode, Griffin.
That's what you got. When you got berries and cream, you make berries and creamenade.
Okay, that's not how any of that works.
He's asking you a question. And these two elves, which you kind of surmise just because they're like standing between you and him, are probably his bodyguards. The half-elf guy has his longbow drawn on the three of you. Have you been following us this whole time? Answer me.
No.
No.
What brings you to the Felicity Wilds?
What?
Big bubble?
We had
it was a big, big bubble bar.
Oh wait, good. Okay, this is a common misconception. Are you asking what conveyed us here? Like, through what method did we arrive, or for what purpose?
What is your goal for being here? Why are you here?
Ah, see, that's the confusion, guys. You thought
not to follow you.
No, we're here because the Wonderland thing. And we're going to
say that, he sort of stands up with a start and walks over and whispers into the half elf's ear. And he says, Sterling says, turn around and leave these woods. Don't try to follow us any further or my mercenaries will kill you.
Secrets are no fun.
When he says that, the elves kind of like roll their eyes. And that the half elf man says, "Hey, are you guys mercs?"
Sort of.
Yeah,
that's a good. That's a useful. Yeah, you know what?
Potato.
Yeah, let's go with mercs.
I mean, I'm a level 10 fighter, level 2 rogue, so I think merc fits that pretty good.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Nice. I'm a level 14 ranger.
Nice. High five.
I'm a level 20 liar.
No, you're not.
As you're like talking to this half elf who has kind of like a friendly demeanor, Lord Artemis Sterling seems like he's kind of frustrated. And you also notice that he has, and it's weird, he has like a beam of light coming out of him that is like pointing him towards the woods, toward like deeper into the woods.
Is Artemis, Griffin, is Artemis armed?
Yeah, he's got a short bow on him. And the elven woman turns to Sterling and is like, "Listen, there's no need for us to fight about anything. They're just going to Wonderland too. We can all go together, and the next time a chimera comes around, it'll make the trip a little bit easier." And Sterling is kind of protesting. He does not want to roll with the three of y'all.
"Hey, look, short pants, let the adults take care of this, okay?"
"How dare you, sir? Do you have any idea who I am?"
"No, actually, of the three of us, I'm the only one with a really bad perception roll, so
that did happen.
I don't know who he is."
"I am Lord Artemis Sterling, the ruler of Highwinter. I keep saying Highwinter. Sometimes I call it, I'm trying to change the name of Neverwinter to Highwinter because I think it sounds funnier, like a weed joke. Anyway, I don't want to go with these guys. We don't know them. They might just be following us. They might just be using us to get to Wonderland, and then they'll try and kill us. I don't want to go with these."
"Listen, let's get one thing straight. We are going to use you to get to Wonderland, but we're not going to try to kill you once we're there. So that's 50-50, I guess.
And
that's
a
win-win.
You can use us too. We'll use each other. That's what friendship is."
The ranger smiles and he lowers his bow. He's like, "I like these guys. Let's just go with them. Sterling, you got to trust me on that. You hired us to get you through these woods, and that means using all the resources at your disposal. And these boys look like good resources. Hey, do you guys want some jerky?" And he pulls some jerky out. Yeah.
"What's your name, friend?"
"My name is. Let me try and look it up.
Okay.
Oh, my name's Rowan. I live here in these woods and just trying to help get the boy king here into Wonderland."
"Rowan, you and I are going to be BFF. Should we come up with some kind of like secret handshake or something?"
"I think we shouldn't come up with it. I think let's just put our hands together right now and see what happens."
"All right, let's do it."
"You just do it."
"Is it
you
amazing?
Just do it, Griffin, and it's an amazing. Cool? It's a 14-step secret handshake, and it's really, really great." The druid woman walks over to you, Merle, and like without saying a word, just like kind of grabs your soulwood arm and like starts like inspecting it. She's like, are you part dryad? Are you a tree folk? What is this? This is awesome."
"You've heard of having a green thumb?"
"Yeah."
"Yeah, this was just like a green thumb thing gone totally wrong. No, Pan gave me this. My god, Pan. He allowed it to happen."
"Oh, I like Pan." She smiles and lets go of your arm. She's like, "Sorry,
Dad,
I got
have you been sick? Because your voice is evolving into like a really cool level. I'm really digging
really
it.
Neat.
I am really sick. Thank you for asking."
"Yeah, you sound super cool."
She releases your arm and she looks a little bit disappointed. She's like, "Oh, that's. I mean, it's cool. I was hoping it was sort of a dryad situation, but
it is. It is.
Yeah,
it's like I've got like a third cousin that's 60% dryad."
"Okay,
he's like a treeborg."
"Treeborg. Ooh, I'm stealing that. Treeborg.
I've been sitting here for 3 minutes trying to come up with something better than treeborg." "Tree doesn't rhyme with sigh. It's a stupid pun. It's like
dryborg.
Pun.
Dryborg.
Dryborg's pretty good.
Dryborg's not bad. That's better."
I think while you guys are sort of getting to know
Big
these
bag
two.
Of treedleborg.
Okay.
Sycamore Borg.
All right, we're done.
No, we're just saying things.
While you two are getting, or you three are getting to know these elves, I think Sterling just kind of starts to walk off into the woods. And as he goes, the the two elves kind of chase after him. And the six of you make your way through the Felicity Wilds, and it's a quiet trip. There's no more three-headed monstrosities to fight on your trek to Wonderland.
But, on the way, can I ask Sterling what's up with the beam of light?
He says, it's none of your business, okay? It's my way of finding Wonderland, all right?
Oh, so we'll just follow the weird Care Bear stare you got kicking there, and it'll get us safely there, right?
He sighs, and he's like, yeah, that's the idea, and keeps walking.
During this, really Rowan and Magnus are just trading jerky stories.
Yeah. About
different places where they've had different kinds of jerky they've had.
Rephrase that a little.
Yeah. I will not. I said what I said, and I'm standing by it.
Your trip is aside from Sterling, who's kind of a heel, you get to know these other two elves, Rowan and Antonia, and you all kind of have a lot in common. They are mercenaries hired to get him through the forest, and they're pretty friendly. Merle, you and Antonia spend a lot of time just talking tree, and you share some jerky with Rowan, and you all have a fairly good time. And after about a half day's journey, you reach a clearing, and it's a huge clearing. Actually, it's carved out of the forest in a perfect circle, and in the middle of that circle is Wonderland, and it's a squat, wide, cylindrical building with these large floodlights positioned all around it, shining on its surface. And the building, the exterior of the building, is painted in these vertical white and black stripes. But it's not, you realize it's not paint, because that pattern is actually moving. It's like spinning in a circle, like rotating around the exterior of this cylinder. And it almost looks like a giant roulette wheel. And you notice that Artemis's beam is leading you down a dirt path towards Wonderland. And as you look around this clearing, you realize it's one of maybe a dozen dirt paths, all leading from different parts of the woods directly towards Wonderland. And you actually see on a couple of the paths, you see a couple other beams of light, apparently leading other people in from the woods, as if this thing is like attracting folks from all over. And the dirt path that you are sort of directed down is lined with billboards, big, tall billboards. And they're kind of, the design of them is like just as gaudy and loud as the flyer invitation that the director showed you. And it's showcasing the prizes awaiting within. And you see your names, Taco, Merle, Magnus, on a big billboard, and you see the Animus Bell on your billboard, and it looks exactly like it did on the director's invitation. But there's three other billboards also. You see one with Sterling's name on it, and on Sterling's billboard, there's a big, intricately sort of crafted glass vial of silvery liquid. And the billboard calls this vial Miracle Milk. And he kind of gasps when he sees it and motions to the mercs. And they have their own billboards, too. Antonia has a billboard with an anatomically correct heart made out of gnarled wood. And it's called the Heart of the Forest. And she kind of, when she sees this, she goes, huh, I didn't think I would have one. And then there's a billboard for Rowan, too, and it has just a plain leather band on it, and it's labeled Carmine's Collar. And he just kind of, when he sees it, he just goes like, huh, interesting. And so that is the approach into Wonderland, and the other three people in your party start walking in towards the building.
Out into the darkness, I see there's one for Merle, and it's a prosthetic penis. It's so strange. It's like, replace what you have lost and perhaps never had.
Like, his wiener got taken away
today. Yeah.
When did that happen?
I don't remember.
I'm just reading the billboard. I'm just looking at the billboard.
It's in one of those bonus episodes we've recorded that hasn't aired yet. You'll hear it.
Oh,
you'll hear it.
When the wiener grabber came and he took your wiener away to the wiener dimension.
Hi, everybody. I got another wiener.
That sounds like Mickey Mouse.
Yep.
Now it's like a Kingdom Hearts thing.
Hey, I got your wiener.
People keep wondering when the two shows will cross over, and here it is, right here.
Here it is. I'm going to give this wiener to my buddy Toodles. He's going to take it away forever.
Hold on just one moment. This seems a little simple, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, Rowan says, you guys get that this is a big trap, right? Like, it's a hugely deadly trap.
But this whole walkway is just lined with like, yeah, everything's going to be good. Here's all your prizes. Just walk on through.
Yeah, but it's like a trap. Like, we have been, Rowan, referring to this little adventure of ours as the Suffering Game. It's a nickname we came up with. We don't even know why we're calling it that. We just kind of feel like it's going to go bad.
Yeah, I mean, it's not great, but I the money is really good for this job, and now that I know that collar's in there, I kind of can't not go in.
I understand. Wait right here for just 1 second, and Magnus pulls out his shield and just sprints down the path.
Okay. Doing what?
Just kind of
being
like...
stupid?
No, you know, bobbing and weaving, serpentine, lots of unnecessary rolls.
All right, you do some fucking Paul Blart Mall Cop style antics as you roll and bob and weave your way down the path. And there's no landmines. There's no trip wires. You just make it to the building, and the other five people are just like looking at you, I guess. Like,
everything's cool. I thought there might be traps, but everything's fine.
Yep.
So you thought the trap would be in the road to the trap?
I thought it seemed pretty simple because it was just like a pathway. And we started with like a fight and a thing. So I thought maybe there'd be more things. You know what? In retrospect, I realized how that looked.
So cool. Is your answer. It looked so cool.
I'm guessing the rest of you follow down the approach now that there's no...
At regular speed, like regular adult speed.
No cartwheels.
Yeah, sure. No flip-flops.
No rolls.
Stunts.
You make it to the building, and the pattern, this black and white roulette wheel pattern, stops spinning. You see a black segment has stopped sort of in your direction.
And it stopped spinning for us? Like, does it seem to have stopped because we approached it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Is it all leading to a central... Are all these different roads leading to, like, a central entrance?
Yeah, it's leading to this huge cylindrical building. And as the wheel stops on this black segment, a portion of the wall just sort of slides away, and all of a sudden there is an entrance into the building, and...
What you've been describing, Griffin, just so I know I can picture it correctly, it's kind of like a kinetoscope where like it's segmented, and if you're looking, it's spinning past going white, black, white, black, white, black, white, black, right?
Yeah, kind of.
Okay, and stopped on a specific segment when we walked up. Okay.
And this doorway opens in the wall, and three names appear above it. And the names are Antonia Rowan and Lord Artemis Sterling. And Sterling doesn't say anything. He doesn't wish you guys goodbye. He doesn't even address you. He's sort of continuing his streak of being a dick that he's carried on throughout your journey through the woods. And he just walks in, and Rowan sighs, and he says, well, guys, I guess I'll see you on the other side. Oh, he reaches into his bag, and he pulls out a small container of extra jerky, and he hands it to you, Magnus. He says, in case you guys get hungry in there.
And I reach into my bag and pull out a small carved wooden duck.
He says, wow, this is great. Antonio, did you see this?
I made that just for you, buddy, while we were walking.
I carved
it while I was rolling down the pathway.
and Rowan walks into the door and sort of disappears into that black space.
Does there seem to be any interaction between the light and the roulette wheel, or was that really just guiding him to the wheel?
It was just sort of guiding him in. Like it was
like less. It didn't seem like a key or anything. It just seemed to.
No, it's almost like a siren song. Like you follow the light to Wonderland.
Can we see the other people going in the other entrances from the?
No, there's nobody.
Paths?
There's nobody else making their approach in this clearing right now. They're just like on their way. You kind of assume. Antonia says, good luck, boys. Sorry about Lord Sterling. He's kind of kind of a ding dong.
I'm used to it.
I hope we'll see you guys again. Good luck in there.
Best of luck.
Smell you later.
Peace.
And she walks into the roulette wheel, and the door closes, and the names disappear, and they're gone. And then the wheel spins some more, and it ends after a few rotations on a white space, and another door appears, and this one has your guys' names on it. And there's nothing beyond it except just inky blackness.
So it's a white door with inky blackness.
Yeah. Like, it's not like... It's not just dark inside. It's black. Like, it's like you're yeah. It's less, it's kind of less like a doorway and more like a portal.
Magnus is already inside.
Oh shit. Wait, okay.
Merle turns and says, "Hey Magnus, what the hell?"
Yeah, I'm not sure about this one, fellas. I mean, I'm trying to be true to Taco. And this seems whack as all hell.
Griffin, can I step back out real quick?
Yeah.
I grab Taco and run inside.
Son of a bitch.
Okay. Merle, you follow in suit?
Yeah, I waddle on in.
Okay. As soon as you're through the passageway, you look behind you, and it's like, it wasn't even like a door shut menacingly behind you. It's just not there. You are in a chamber that is so dark you can barely see. Even those of you with dark vision, I think everybody but Magnus has like special eyes that they can see in the dark. You can't really see much of anything. You can just kind of make out the shapes of things. You can tell it's a huge chamber, bigger even than it appeared on the outside. But after a few moments, everything is illuminated. There's a row of spotlights on the ceiling that click on, and these two big rotating floodlights on the ground that activate and shine upwards, and they cross on the center of the chamber, and you see two figures standing on a long elevated platform. They are beautiful elves, one female, one male. And they are dressed in these tight-fitting, high-fashion garments of gold and green and violet. He's wearing a golden half-cape with fur trim, and she's wearing these huge, insane golden shoulder pads. And you realize the long platform they're standing on is a runway. And the female elf sticks a slender, gloved arm into the air and snaps. And all of a sudden, the ceiling and walls and floor of this room transform into 1,000 multicolored neon panels that shift and flash in time with loud, pulsating music that floods the chamber. And every time like the beat hits on this song, the spotlights flash in time. And every time they do, they catch this duo as they just fucking vogue and pose their way down the runway, just like working it. Just like hitting the beats so fucking hard and just voguing their brains out.
This should go without saying at this point, Taco is delighted. Like, fucking finally we go someplace cool. It's been so long, and finally we are at someplace that is worth visiting.
And they reach the end of the runway, which is just this large circular platform. And as they do, the rest of the runway descends down into the ground to be about, you know, floor level. And this circle platform spins around a few times as they continue to pose to the music. And finally, they address you. And I'm going to need two voices here.
Fucking amazing.
They say, I might just do like Jesse James. Jesse and James from Pokemon.
Yes, please.
Yes.
But Jesse kind of sounds like Taco already. Well, okay, I'm not worried about it. The male elf says, "You made it. Welcome to Wonderland." And the woman says, "Hopefully you didn't have too much trouble navigating the wilds."
Meowf.
I would meowf there.
And suddenly the male elf is behind you, Taco, and he's got his hand on your shoulder, although weirdly you can't like feel it. He's like weightless, and he says, "Are you excited for your quest's end? Whatever you seek, you will find it in Wonderland."
I wasn't before, but I'm getting pretty jazzed now.
And the woman is behind you now, Magnus, with her hand on your shoulder, and she says, it's not going to come. It's it's not going to come easy, though, dear. Are you prepared for that?
What? Was that an innuendo?
She winks.
I'm very uncomfortable.
She winks. Maybe. And all of a sudden, they're both back up on top of the platform.
Hey, are they casting shadows, Griffin?
No, they're not.
Didn't think so.
She says, he says, the rules are simple. You will be evaluated.
Are you guys holograms?
What's that?
Are you hologram? Are you illusions?
Are you Jim?
She says, when we look this good, does it really matter? And she votes.
No!
One more time.
No, I mean, no, he's right. No.
Shut the fuck up!
Okay.
The rules are simple. You will be evaluated through a series of tests and games in order to determine the extent to which you truly want your prize. And she says, the tests will be rough, but they're important. In Wonderland, you can only find the things you truly desire by losing the things that hold you back. You follow the rules of the tests, you push through the pain, and you will leave here happy. And he says, you break the rules, you try to find shortcuts, and you won't leave here happy. Ready to get started?
I have one question.
Shoot.
Are you guys taking applications, or like, what's the story vis-a-vis employment? I have skills, whatever. Several references, these dunces, others that are dead.
She laughs, and he kind of looks at her seriously, like he's thinking about it a little bit.
Yes!
And he says, let's see if you can make it through Wonderland. If that's what you truly desire, maybe it'll be waiting for you at the end of your trials.
Hell yeah.
And they lift their arms up in the air and snap, and just like that, they disappear. And that circular panel that they were standing on lowers to about waist height, and you realize that this spinning platform they were standing on, it actually is a giant wheel, like a roulette wheel that is cut into various multicolored sections, each with a different symbol on it. And the two floodlights on the ground rotate to shine on a large stone door at the opposite end of the room, and above that door are three dim red circular panels. And the symbols on this wheel, really quick, are there's an eye, there's one that looks just like a body, there's a skull, there's one that looks like a brain, there's one that looks like a backpack, one that looks like a hand, one that looks like two crossed swords.
Slow down.
No, you don't have to write these down.
Okay. I was trying to like mist / riven this shit.
No, apparently.
It doesn't matter.
No, nothing like that. Two cross swords, there's one of a clock, and then there's a question mark. And you hear a voice say, this is the wheel of sacrifice. You spin it, and you give up whatever it lands on. You are, of course, free to refuse if you land on something you value too much to lose, but there will be a penalty for your reluctance.
Man, I hope it doesn't land on the skull.
After completing enough sacrifices, the door will open. And the voices are gone, and all of the lights, all the spotlights in the chamber, pivot to shine directly on this wheel in the center of the room. And give me a second.
I got to tell you, the production values in Wonderland are stunning. They are absolutely beautiful.
So this wheel is before you, in order to open the large stone door at the other end of the chamber, you will need to sacrifice three things.
Is this the kind of thing where we each do it once, or every time we click it, all three of us have to sacrifice whatever comes up?
You hear the voice explain to you that each of you will take one turn at a time, and you spin the wheel, and whoever spun the wheel is the one who will have to do the sacrificing.
Cool. I will go first.
Okay. I dropped a link into Skype for you to a website called Wheel Decide. Thank you, Wheel Decide, sponsor of the show this week, for this good internet software So click that wheel and it should spin and you tell me what it lands on.
Hand.
Hand. Okay. You hear those voices again. And you hear what do I want to do? Hand. How gnarly do I want to be to start out? And you hear the woman's voice say, oh, not too gnarly. They're just getting, we don't want to discourage them right from the beginning. And you hear the man's voice say, okay, how about this? One finger. You get to pick it. I won't choose it for you. You get to pick the finger. You won't even have to, like, cut it off. We're not going to have another Crystal Kingdom debacle on our hands. You just pick it, and then, boop.
If you do want to cut it off, though, I'll help him out.
This is not that bad. It's just, you've got 10 of them. You're being greedy, actually.
Actually, we've never discussed this, but Magnus has actually born with 11 fingers.
No.
No? Okay.
So it has to be the person who spun the wheel that makes the sacrifice, or any of the three of us can make the sacrifice.
No, the one who spun the wheel is the one that does it. And honestly, if it is too much, if you are going to be selfish about this, you don't have to do it, but there will be a small penalty.
Okay. So just so I understand the parameters, if I don't do it, I'm not disqualified from moving forward.
God, no. I want you to move forward.
This is tricky, you see, because I'm sitting here thinking both as like a carpenter and a wood carver and a fighter and a rogue, losing a finger, even like a pinky, could be detrimental.
Yeah, but if you think about all those professions, statistically speaking, you should have lost a couple already.
That's an excellent point.
Kind of ahead of the game, really.
This is just such a big... All right, yeah. Take, fuck me. None of my gloves will fit.
Not the thumb.
I'm not losing the thumb.
This is so sad. I feel so bad for you.
A whole finger.
Losing a whole finger.
I chopped off your hand.
Hootie fucking who?
I chopped off your hand to save your life. I'm chopping off a finger to win a game.
Mm-hmm. A very good game.
Fuck. Any chance you tell us what the penalty is?
Absolutely not.
Okay. Yeah. Take my left pinky. God damn.
Just as soon as you say that, Magnus, it's just gone. And there's no... It hurts a bit, but it doesn't...
Oh, shit. Come on.
It doesn't sting that bad. There was no, like, blade that popped out. It's just your finger, your pinky, where it once was...
I hate this game.
Now gone. And what are you wearing? Let's say it's on your non-dominant hand, right?
Yeah, I think that's the Fletcher's mitt.
So just the pinky of your Fletcher's mitt. The pinky on your Fletcher's mitt is now just like empty and it's just kind of hanging down. But yeah, your left pinky is gone. And as soon as it disappears, you hear a bing. And one of those three red circular panels above that stone door at the other end of the room turns bright green. Magnus, while you were kind of grousing about the shittiness of losing a finger, while you were doing that, make a perception check for me.
16. Plus one, 17.
You know how when it's cold, you can see your breath when you talk?
Uh-huh.
It was kind of like that for a second. With a 17, that's what you kind of see.
It's like breathing out fog?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay. Next.
That wasn't that bad. Let's go.
No, that was nice. I kind of enjoyed it.
Hey everybody, I'm Griffin McElroy, your Dungeon Master, your best friend, and your personal chef. I hope you kids like spaghetti. Thank you for listening to episode 52 of The Adventure Zone, the second episode in our new arc, which is called The Suffering Game. It's a dark, dramatic turn for the franchise. we're going to take things in such a moody direction. You're going to flip your shit. Thanks again for listening. I do want to get a big thanks here before we get into the Money Zone spot of the show. Big thanks to Zachary Wilson, who did the song that you just heard. That was sort of the theme for Wonderland. The song's called Storm Top Dog. Zachary Wilson's really great. I've been listening to his stuff on SoundCloud for a while. You can find his music at soundcloud.com/Zachary Wilson. That's Z-A-C-K-E-R-Y, Zachary Wilson. Or on Bandcamp at zwmusic.bandcamp.com. And again, Zachary, thank you very much for letting me use that song. As soon as I heard it, I like became obsessed with using it in this particular scene. So thanks again. This week, the Adventure Zone is sponsored in part by NatureBox. NatureBox, you've had us in your ears telling you what's so great about NatureBox. And at this point, you probably had NatureBox in your gob, just treating you so right with all kinds of robust, healthy, delicious flavors. You don't have to goof around with a bunch of nutrition labels. You don't have to read that spreadsheet of nutrition that nobody, if somebody says they know what that says on it, they're lying to try to impress you. So NatureBox is just simple. You get the snacks, they deliver them right to your door. They have over 100 ridiculously delicious snacks. They're made with better for you ingredients. You just choose what snacks you want and they're delivered right to your door. They got snacks like cinnamon yogurt pretzels and sour cream and onion straws and honey crunch crisps. They got garlic plantains. They got all kinds of tasty, tasty stuff. You should definitely be getting down on NatureBox if you aren't already. You can get on board right now if you go to naturebox.com/adventure, and you will get 2 bags of delicious snacks without any of the junk for free. That's naturebox.com/adventure. Get your 2 free bags of bold and unique snacks delivered right to you. Again, one last time, naturebox.com/adventure, and get 2 bags of snacks for free, you goobus. I'm sorry about that. It's late. I'm tired. I'm starting to get sick. I called you a goobus, and I feel bad about it because some words you just can't take back. I got a few Jumbotron spots for you as well. And again, just another reminder, if you want to get a message on the show, we ran out of spots for 2016 pretty quickly, actually. And we haven't sold any Jumbotron spots for a while. We're going to open up a batch for 2017. And those are going to go on sale November 28th. That's Cyber Monday at noon Pacific time. So if you want to get a message on the show, 2017 is going to be the earliest you can do it. And this is going to be the best time to buy those because I guarantee they're going to sell out. If you want to do that, just go to MaximumFun.org/Jumbotron. Got a message here for, CRNO Bog. And it's from Hamled and the rest of the hashtag Kobol crew, in spirit, if not in actual expressed interest, which is a very honest and wonderful way of filling out that particular field. They say, really looking forward to hearing Griffin read that name. Yeah, thanks. So the game is done. It's on the way to Walmart right now, or already sold out if this is late. The day one patch is submitted for validation. You did it. You made that happen. Take a nice long break and find your next challenge. You deserve it, man. I'm certainly proud of you. That's for, they wanted that one to come out October 3rd, so it sounds like this game sold out, got that GOTY status, got that 10 out of 10, got the 5 out of 5 fun factor, the Kids' Choice Awards, all kinds of people are just weighing in saying what a great thing this is that you made. So congratulations, Cernobog, and I don't know what this is talking about, but I'm very proud of you. Got a message here for Craig. Sorry I said your name like that. I have a message here, and it's for Craig. And it's from Jake, who says, Craig is a big fan of the Adventure Zone. So I thought I would ask you guys to wish him a happy birthday. Craig, may you have a great year full of fun adventures. Ah, Craig, you did it, didn't you? Craig, you did it again. Craig, I'm so proud of you. Your birthday is, it says, around November 16th. That was yesterday, so crushing it. And now, Craig, I feel like I'm also celebrating a birthday. And thank you for sharing this experience with me. I have another message here, and it's for Dad and my sweet baby brother, Pierce. And it's from your DM, who says, congrats to us for maintaining our own adventure zone. Despite being spread out between the UK, Maryland, and Virginia, we've managed to maintain our fortnightly family D&D session on the reg. As I prepare to move to Berlin, I'm confident it will change nothing except maybe some more disturbing monsters and more delicious snack breaks. Yeah, that is a, that's God. It's hard enough to get your family together to play D&D, every other week when you live all across the continental United States. If, mixing in international time zones, that is a Herculean feat. And I'm very jealous of your family's organizational skills. I want to say thank you to everybody who has been tweeting about the show using the Zonecast hashtag. If you do so, you might not end up as a character in the show as a sorry patron of Wonderland. I'm talking about folks like Lord Artemis Sterling, who's named for Chris Sterling. That's Lyo by four. I butchered that. Sorry. On Twitter, I'm talking about folks like Rowan, Polite Botanist, on Twitter, Antonia, named for Antonia De Pieri. That's Tonya Rhea. Oh, Jesus. Tonya Arena on Twitter. There's some more folks that are going to be included in this arc. And if you want to end up, with your name on one of those folks, you can do so. Just tweet about the show using the Zonecast hashtag, and you might just do it. And let's get back into it. The next episode's going to be up on, I think it's going to be December 1st, and that's crazy. Yeah, holy shit, December 1st. So Rachel and my wife and I are expecting a baby very early December. So there's a chance that the next episode might be a live show episode from our show at Max Fun Con East in the Poconos, which was a lot of fun. I'm very excited for you to hear that. But it may also just be the next episode in the Suffering Game arc. And we will try to let you know on Twitter ahead of time what episode you can expect on December 1st. And till then, keep it real. See you later. Bye. Who's going?
I guess I will. Spinning. Holy crap!
I'll let Taco tell you.
He got eye.
Eye. Okay.
Aye.
You hear the woman say, "Oh, this is a real shame. You have such beautiful, beautiful dwarven eyes. I've always preferred Hazel. Dwarven eyes. Hazel, beautiful Hazel dwarven eyes. This sacrifice. We're not going to take an eye from you. Don't worry about that.
Woo!
Just close. Some of your, let's say, keen dwarven vision. So for this sacrifice, you will lose dark vision. You will
what
not be able
fuck?
To see
I
in the dark
I lost a pinky,
anymore.
He loses dark vision?
I should also mention you didn't lose any like tangible skills for your pinky loss.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
I think you should have to subtract one.
From what? Levels.
Everything.
Every roll? No.
Everything involving his left hand. What do you say? What do you say, Merle? This is a breeze.
Could I give up an eye?
Not yet.
Yet. Okay. Yeah, go ahead. Take it.
You sound dissatisfied by this. This exchange.
No, No. Listen. I'm completely used to it. I can't drive at night. I have shitty vision already. Take the darkness vision crap.
Okay. As soon as you say that, your vision kind of changes. It's kind of like when you're taking a vision test and they're trying on the different lenses to find out your prescription, and they switch you to a lens that is just like not good. You can still see just fine, but like this room, the parts of it that aren't illuminated by spotlight are kind of dim. And so like all of a sudden you realize you can't see those parts of the room as well. And Taco and Magnus, you notice that the color in his beautiful hazel eyes kind of drains away, leaving him with just like dark gray irises. And with that, a second panel above that door at the end of the room flashes green, and you hear another ding.
Cool.
Fine. Fine, I'll go.
Taco, it seems like you're not enjoying the game very much.
No, it's been pretty good so far. I mean, so far. Yeah, I got Skull.
Skull's a nasty one. Skull is sort of like delayed gratification. Well, not for you, for me. All Skull means is at some point in the future, you will face some pretty bad luck. I'm not going to tell you what that means necessarily, but I will be honest, it won't be great. What do you say, Taco?
Nah.
You're turning this one down?
Well, now hold on, Taco. Before you do, take a look at the other things on that wheel. There's not like a good one.
Yeah, but my rationale is that there's a chance I won't have to suffer the penalty alone, right? It may be something that impacts all three of us.
Yeah, right? but I'm not spinning again.
I do want to point out, it will only affect you, Taco. It's your burden to bear.
Hey, bud, I'll spin again if you want me to.
No, I mean, it's a skull. That's what I got. Yeah, fine, I'll take the bad luck.
Okay. You say that, and you don't experience any change. And a green light above the door in front of you flashes on, and very slowly the wheel descends into the ground, and the stone door slides open.
Griffin, I want to ask, while Taco was kind of hemming and hawing there, did I notice anything? Was there any kind of... Could we see his breath, too?
No. You didn't notice anything. Just, you know, him and Merle were kind of being a little, what's the word I'm looking for? Hesitant? But no, you didn't notice anything really coming from them.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. The door in front of you is now open, and, you see another chamber that is just kind of, like, pitch black. That you cannot sort of, you can't really see through.
Well, that just went great. You know what? I'm going to get into the next one first, because if it's anywhere near as cool as this one, I want to be the first to see it. So out of the way, Taco's rushing in.
What? Okay. Magnus follows him.
Merle's good out here.
What's going on? Okay, so not all three of you. Boy, I don't like it when you guys don't all go through doors at the same time.
Merle goes in.
Okay, you enter into the next chamber, and let me find where I'm at. As you step into this like void, you realize that you're walking on some sort of floor. You don't just sort of fall out into space. And again, as soon as the three of you like walk through that doorway, it vanishes. It is just gone. And in this pitch black room, you see a single point of light about 30 feet ahead of you. And as you approach it, you realize that this light is coming from a small pedestal that is about chest high, and it's got two buttons on it, on top of it. And going around the exterior of this cylindrical pedestal is a screen that wraps all the way around the span of the pedestal. And on this cylindrical screen are pixelated illustrations of your guys' faces. And you hear the woman's voice say, "Only one of you will play this particular game. Let's find out who it's going to be." And all of a sudden the faces start spinning around the podium, and it stops on Merle.
Ooh, yeah.
You hear the man say, you
high five,
the
Taco.
The male elf say, "Merle, approach the podium."
Okay.
You walk towards the podium, and the buttons illuminate, and they have words on them. And one of the buttons reads, "Trust," and the other one reads, "Forsake." And you hear a voice say, "The rules of this game are simple. You all probably know this already, but you're not the only ones currently making your way through Wonderland right now.
This section of the game will be something of a competitive mode. Right now, there's another group in another chamber identical to the one you're standing in now. Now, the next room you'll face will feature a deadly, deadly challenge. But based on your decision in this room, you can change your fate in the next. And the woman says, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Very few survive our challenges. They're designed to push you to your breaking point, which is not a place that many folks are capable of returning from. An advantage such as the one that you can secure in this chamber will be invaluable if you want to reach the end of Wonderland intact.
Press for sake!
You...
Hey, press for sake!
Quiet, please. You...
Go ahead, press for sake now!
You, Merle, and a
It might be a speed thing! Press for sake!
You,
go
Merle...
It's probably timed!
Trust!
It's probably timed! Go ahead, press for sake! I have magic! Let me get Bigby's hand up in here.
You.
Merle, you gotta trust.
Merle, you and a representative for that other group will decide what fates await your parties. Now, if both of you select trust, you'll both face the challenge as it was normally designed. And as I mentioned before, that means you'll face a trial that you may not walk away from. But you don't have to face that trial. And the woman says, that's what the Forsake button is for. Now, if you both get greedy and choose Forsake, that's bad news. You'll both face a more difficult version of the trial, and these more challenging trials will probably kill you. And the man says, but if you choose Forsake and your opponent chooses Trust, then that's great news for you. You don't have to face the trial at all. Your opponent's team, however, will face a nearly impossible version of the challenge. And the room illuminates with these bright, multicolored rings that originate from the base of that pedestal and slowly sort of work their way around the room, like encompassing it as this tense, like, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire-style music starts playing.
Where's the other group?
You don't get to know who the other group or who the representative for that group is going to be.
Okay.
But where are they? I mean, are they here?
They're in Wonderland, absolutely.
How far away?
Space is kind of a weird abstract concept in here. I wouldn't worry about it.
Listen, Merle, I thought about this. You got a 1 in 3 chance of it being bad and a 2 in 3 chance of it being better. So if you hit trust and they hit trust, it's great. But if you both hit forsake, then it's bad. It's worse than before.
All right, Taco, make your case.
Yeah, forsake, my dude. They're going to forsake us. They're vagabonds. I'll tell you who the other group is.
But, Taco, if he hits forsake and they hit forsake.
So, I will say this. To your credit, the only thing I will say is, as near as I can figure, there's a 2 out of 3 chance that the person on the other side is going to press trust.
Mm-hmm.
Because 2 of the 3 that we encountered were not total dillweeds.
Yep.
So there's a 2 out of 3 chance that they're going to trust. Now, if it's a stink pants or Archie of Bakedville or whoever he was trying to name his town, he is going to forsake, and that would be the pits for sure. But it's our podcast, so we're not going to die. So let's say trust.
The final decision's up to Merle, and I'm going to count it that once you tell me what it is, you press the button, and there will be no more deliberating after that.
Okay. The dryad lady kind of had a thing for me. I could tell just looking at her. So trust!
Okay. You put your hand on the trust button and push it down, and as soon as you do, the music comes to a stop, and there's no fanfare or anything like that. The room's walls all just illuminate white, and the far wall opposite to the one that you all came in through, you see words start to appear, and it says, your decision, and then in big green letters, trust appears, and then you see their decision, and in bright red letters, the word forsake appears.
Son of a bitch.
But you know what? It doesn't matter. If we had both forsaken, that would have been even worse.
I do want to be clear. This is the worst possible outcome for you guys. Those words disappear and a door opens on that wall where the screen was leading into the next chamber.
So we don't get to find out who pressed the button?
Nope.
Okay.
I got a theory.
I don't want to go.
It's going to be fine. Don't worry about it.
Something bad's going to happen. No.
Wait, are we all going? I thought he had to face it on his own.
What?
No, you all go on to the next challenge chamber.
What? You suck.
Let's go.
As you said that, Merle, Magnus, now that you kind of know to look for it, you see that same fog kind of come out of Merle's mouth and kind of just sort of float up into the ceiling.
I see. Hey, Taco?
Yeah.
Are you vaping?
No, it's in there when I was like, oh, I don't want to cut off my pinky. And now in here when Merle was all like, I don't want to go in there, bad guy. This like fog stuff came out of our mouths. What's that?
I'm going to roll an Arcana check.
Okay.
See if I have any clue. Whoa.
Crit 20.
That's a flash of nat 20.
Oh, really?
I know exactly what the fuck that is. No problem. Let me open my mouth, and my voice might sound different, but I'm about to say something very smart about it.
So,
here
so
I go.
Here's what I'll tell you, because that roll is too good for me to not tell you something. You noticed it, too. You noticed this it's like a dark fog that came out of their mouths whenever Magnus, you know, kind of groused about getting his pinky chopped off, and when Merle was talking about how much this sucks, you saw this dark fog come out of their mouths, and whenever they said it, you don't know like what's causing it, but it is some sort of necrotic energy that is leaving them and sort of being spirited away somewhere here in Wonderland.
Taco didn't even want to come in.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So here's my best guess, boys. My best guess is that this place...
Wait, hold on. Pocket Spa, step in here with me real quick.
Okay.
Or Pocket Workshop.
Yeah, let's go to the spa, please. I need a break. All right, so the Pocket Spa is open, and we can walk into the Pocket Spa. So before we move on,
that noise? It's not in a canyon.
No, that's 528 hertz. In case you don't know, that's the miracle tone that is supposed to enable you to relax.
So this is very soothing. So here's my best guess. This place isn't trying to kill us.
Uh-huh.
It just wants to make us miserable.
Uh-huh.
And it seems like it's feeding off of that. That's my best guess. This is a place designed to make us miserable. And every time that we vocalize that, it knows that it is succeeding and it's feeding off of that energy. That's my best guess.
I like that. So do you think it's better to give it what it wants or to stay super positive?
What am I, the fucking necrotic energy whisperer? I have no idea.
Listen, this is we very rarely talk through this kind of shit. I'm very much enjoying it. Just trying to get a vibe on where you're at.
I'm really uncomfortable with it. Let's get out of here.
I mean, I will say this. I don't see any reason to feed it if we don't have to. I mean, it's very much not in our nature to not grouse about, but maybe we should try to stay posy about this whole experience.
Yeah, let's swing towards the positive side of things. All right, let's do this.
Okay. You make your way back out of the pocket spa and into the decision room again, and are you moving on to the next chamber?
Yes, of course we are.
Okay.
Here we go.
Whee!
You move through the door, and you are in another circular room. And
yay! Awesome!
It's also very, like, neon bright, and above you, the whole ceiling is nothing but machinery that is attached to the ceiling, and it's this huge, heavy manufacturing, like assembly line machinery, and
awesome.
It all connects sort of in a spiral, and in the center of the ceiling is a large circular hatch, and as you enter into the room, the doorway disappears behind you. And with three loud clunks, three large boxes fall from the ceiling and land on the ground.
Super cool.
And each box has a these boxes are perfect cubes, and each box has a word etched on a side, and the words are things like fiery and quick and some other adjectives and nouns. And you hear a voice say, "Welcome to the Monster Factory. This is so exciting. Each of you will roll these dice in front of you, and you will build a bespoke foe to square off against. It could be something new altogether. Nobody knows."
Woohoo. Sounds fun.
Now, based on the consequences of the decision game, there mm-hmm. will be some difficulties imposed on you during this challenge, but let's not worry about that. Let's roll those bones.
Sounds good.
Let's do this one at a time. You're going to roll a D6. Tell me who wants to go first, and then pop into Skype, and I'll paste something in there for you.
I'll go first.
All right.
That's Merle, for those listeners who can't tell the difference between our voices.
All right, your dice, Merle, the one that you go pick up, has the name of some monsters on it. So go ahead and roll that.
2.
That is... You roll the big box, and it lands on the word slime. And all then right. that box turns green and disappears.
I will go.
Okay, here are your words. You pick up a dice just covered in these different adjectives.
I rolled a 3.
Poisonous. So poisonous and slime are the words so far. And taco, here are your words.
5.
Regenerating. So you get regenerating poisonous slime.
Cool. Great. Awesome. Yeah, fun.
Yay!
That could have gone so much worse.
Yeah, there's dragon on dire bear and stuff on there.
And you hear a voice. The machinery above you on the right side of the room kicks into gear, and you hear pistons firing, and you hear... steam being blown off, and you hear, yeah, you hear the sounds of industry. But you hear the woman say, "Oh, well, that's so disappointing. I've seen a regenerating poisonous slime before." And you hear the man say, "Oh, well, that's nothing to worry about. They didn't win the decision game, so they're gonna do it again." And 3 more dice fall down from the ceiling.
Son of a
no! What fun!
Taco, a little bit, just like a little bit of that dark fog came out of your mouth.
Damn it.
And floated up in the ceiling, and a little bit more went up.
Fuck!
No joke, every time you do that, just like a little bit more goes up to the ceiling.
You know, I'll just be zen about it.
Okay, I'll roll first this time.
Okay.
4.
Dire bear.
What fun!
Who's rolling the 2. Second dice? 2?
2.
Electrified. Holy shit. Merle?
2.
Flying. Holy shit. A flying electrified dire bear. Now we're talking. Hold on. Sorry. That's in character. Fuck yeah. A flying electrified dire bear. Wonderful. That would be what you would have to face if you both chose betray. But unfortunately, you all are getting the... sharp end of the stick, so to speak. So, 1 more dice. And another dice falls down from the ceiling. I'm not actually going to show you what's on this dice. Who wants to roll it?
Taco?
Sure. 5.
Okay. The word pops up, and it applies to both of the creations that you've created so far. And as soon as it lands, I think you all look at it in horror, and you hear the elves kind of squee in delight, because I think you hear the man say, "Oh, this is delicious! Not only are you facing off against a regenerating poisonous slime and a flying electrified dire bear, you're going to face off against multiplying regenerating poisonous slimes and multiplying flying electrified dire bears. This is going to get zany," he says. And after a few more seconds of the machinery above you processing things, sure enough, falling down through that hatch is a cube of slime that is giving off a horrible, horrible stench that is about 15 feet tall, that slurps down to the ground, and then right behind it, with a pair of beautiful, beautiful angelic wings, is a humongous dire bear with bolts of crackling electricity sort of wrapping around its body, and they roar at you. Let's roll initiative.
MaximumFun.org.
Comedy and culture.
Artist owned.
Listener supported.
Instead of door busting for a plasma TV this Black Friday, how about you stay in and snag the best deal of all? Max FunCon 2017 tickets. Max FunCon West returns to Lake Arrowhead next June, and Max FunCon East is back in the Poconos next September. Tickets for both go on sale Friday, November 25th, and they're gonna sell out fast. So mark your calendars and visit MaxFunCon.com on November 25th to secure your spot. MaxFunCon, way more fun than a smartwatch or whatever.
Is the newest season of The Great British Bake Off any good?
What exactly are furries?
What shows should I binge watch on Netflix?
What movie should I go see this weekend?
Hey, how did Crash win Best Picture? I'm still mad about that.
For answers to these questions and so much more, come on over to Pop Rocket, a pop culture roundtable show with me, Guy Branum,
Winter Mitchell,
Margaret Wappler,
and Oliver Wang.
Catch us every Wednesday on MaximumFun.org or wherever you decide to get your podcasts. I'm not going to judge.